Christian Audio presents David the Great, Deconstructing the Man After God's Own Heart by Mark Rutland. Narrated by Maurice England. If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its cunning. A letter to the listener. Dear listener, for this my 15th book, I chose an informal style, more of a conversational tone. I hope you will feel that I'm talking to you person to person, over coffee perhaps, or rather in an intimate lecture hall. I strove in this book, as in nothing I have written before, to maintain the illusion that I am your jovial old professor, trying desperately to make the Bible and this particular king called David come alive for you, even if I must go against the rules of grammar to do it. Indeed, that is exactly how this book began. I taught the life and times of King David multiple times at two wonderful universities where I served as president. Those lectures proved to be the most popular I ever gave. I was gratified beyond measure to see millennials, and their professors for that matter, pack rooms both grand and small to hear the truth about the Lion of the tribe of Judah. I set out to shred the Sunday school felt bored David and show them the real man, the David of the Bible. I wanted them to learn life lessons from the grit and grime of David's life, his real life, not the Americanized little Christian shepherd boy with his toy slingshot. I strove to tell them the truth, and they and I discovered together the truth is sometimes ugly and complex and messy. We also discovered that truth is worth the mess. I wanted them to listen, of course, but more than that, I wanted them to hear, which is a different thing. Frankly, I did not know if they would tolerate the darkness in order to find the light. I was surprised and delighted that, far from being disgusted by the real King David, they couldn't get enough. They wanted to know David and to hear about his heart for God, and yes, why he sinned as he did. They wanted to understand David. I was afraid that if I made them see his failures, they would dismiss him as that, a failure. Far from it. They said, "Now this ancient king, this is a man we can listen to. This is a voice for our turbulent times." I feared they would be repelled by the contradictions in David's life. They impressed me deeply with their willingness, nay, eagerness, to get down in the muck and dive for pearls. In order to keep them engaged in the struggle, I took a storyteller's license with grammar. When I felt the need, I said, "At this point, David rides into town," rather than "rode into town." It worked. Over the years, I have been asked by literally hundreds of students to do what I at last have done, write this very book. I have chosen, therefore, to maintain a fluidity intense, floating whimsically and quite ungrammatically between present and past tense, just as one might do telling a story rather than writing a textbook. The somewhat quirky violation of everything I learned in my strunk-style manual in college may be jarring to purists. This is not about grammar. This is about the real Lion King. Try to relax. At the same time, you'd best brace yourself. As we used to say in Texas, this is gonna get rowdy. Mark Rutland. Introduction. In all of history, very few people have been afforded the title Great. Mother Russia had Catherine, England had Alfred, Greece had Alexander, and Persia had Cyrus. But the United States has never used the title at all, not even once. There is no Lincoln the Great or Patton the Great. It is that rarest of all historical titles, lusted after and fought for, yet seldom given to the kings of the earth. The title Great is reserved in history for those people who, though perhaps not great in the sense of morality, are simply larger than life, huge personalities on the stage of human history. In the bitterest of historical ironies, the only monarch in Israel's history to be called great was Herod, a consummate psychopath whose reign was a veritable bloodbath, not of glorious conquest, but of heinous murder. Herod the Great killed so many of his own family that the Emperor Augustus joked that it was better to be Herod's pig than his son. Yet Herod's greatness, such as it was, derived from architecture, not glory in battle. He was a great builder of structures, including the famed temple in Jerusalem, but he was also a horrendous destroyer of lives. Nevertheless, he is to this day called Herod the Great. The only king of Israel who merited the honor of being called the Great was not the maniacal Herod, to be sure, but a complex and controversial man who predated Herod by 1,000 years, David of Bethlehem. Even those dismissive of the Bible cannot deny that David is among the most famous names in world literature. Were David nothing but a myth, his story would still be the stuff of the greatest of legends. Giant slayer, warrior chieftain, outlaw, mercenary, lover, poet, musician, and sometime prophet, David is great by any measure. Sculpted, painted, debated, denounced, and denied, David is the greatest of all Israel's rulers. Among the kings of his own or any other age, hardly a man like David exists. He is considered the true father of his nation, though Saul was its first king. One cannot fully understand the history of Israel, nor have a true sense of the Bible as a whole story, without David. Still, some might be hesitant to utter the phrase, David the Great, and understandably so. For every Goliath in the story of David, there is a Bathsheba around the corner. For every soul to whom he showed compassion, there were 100 he was personally responsible for slaughtering. He had many wives, yet his palace was also filled with concubines. He had a different woman for every night of the week. During one lengthy period, David was an outlaw who ran what can only be called a protection racket. Later, he was a mercenary raider who sold his skills to his people's adversaries. He was dreaded by his enemies not only for killing them in great numbers, but, as they saw it, also for sometimes mutilating and desecrating the bodies of the fallen for little more than a bizarre bridal dowry. His own father-in-law hated him. At least one of his wives despised and betrayed him. One of his sons led a revolution against him and would have executed him had not more loyal souls intervened. David caused a devastating plague and, like a mafia don, ordered the execution of his enemies while on his deathbed. Yet he was also a spirit-sensitive poet, whose words have comforted millions worldwide in 2 major religions for 3,000 years. He was a musician whose songs could soothe a demon-haunted soul. He was a political leader, strong enough to forge a single nation out of disparate tribes that had been ripped apart for years by civil war and internecine prejudice. Not least of all, David was a man of passionate loyalty, great faith, and national vision. The name of this ancient Jewish king is known where the Bible is not even read or believed. We must remember, though, that David was not a 21st century Christian. If we try to dress him in a suit and tie and apply our standards of morality to his life, it simply won't work. Jesus' teachings on loving your enemies? After David. Paul's writings on marriage, specifically monogamy? After David. Peter's call to not repay evil with evil? You get the point. The story of the real David, the one I want to introduce you to, the one the Bible describes, could only be found in the adult graphic novel section of your comic book store. There would be no bright colors, capes, or pretty girls being rescued. That's not the Bible's David. The real David steals the pretty girls from their husbands. The real David makes a mess of his family. The real David breaks the laws of both God and man. We need to de-comic book David and tell the real story. The reality is that while David was no saint, neither was he a monster. He was a complex man, perhaps one of the most complicated and conflicted leaders of all time. He was a multifaceted genius, whose abilities in seemingly mutually exclusive genres are unparalleled. He could make war and write soul-piercing poetry with equal facility. We may well be shocked by his sins, but we are also inspired by his victories and moved by his intimacy with the God of Abraham. There is much, ever so much, to learn from his life. Some years ago, I sat writing at a picnic table in Tiberias, Israel. With my manuscript stacked neatly on the table, I was writing at such a furious pace that at first I did not notice the middle-aged woman watching me. When I looked up, she asked if I was an American. When I said yes, she asked what I was writing about. King David, I answered. King David? Yes, you know, from the Bible. Why? She asked with disdain. Why in the world would you write about that bloody man? Obviously, she cherished no notion of him as David the Great, and I knew it was useless to try to explain my lifelong fascination with an ancient king who had ruled so long ago in her land. I asked myself, how great a man is he, whose controversy outlives him by millennia? How great is a man who can inspire equal parts of vitriol, admiration, and curiosity for 3,000 years? So here he is, David, King of Israel, that bloody man, who was also a man after God's own heart. Prologue. In those days, Israel had no king, so the people did whatever seemed right in their own eyes. Judges chapter 21, verse 25. Look no further than the final verse in the book of Judges to describe the era in which David arose. The people did whatever seemed right in their own eyes. Although David is the lead character in the story of the birth of the nation of Israel, the second character is the time in which he lived. David lived in an era far different from ours, so different, in fact, that truly understanding what that period was like defies the most fertile imagination. The genealogy in Matthew chapter 1 helps put David's moment in history into perspective. Salmon was the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz was the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed was the father of Jesse. Jesse was the father of King David. Verses 5 through 6. We're not sure who Salmon was, but he may have been one of the spies sent into Jericho by Joshua. Rahab was the pagan prostitute who helped the Hebrew spies before they invaded Jericho. Salmon and Rahab, sometime after the fall of Jericho, married and had a boy they named Boaz. Boaz became kinsman redeemer for a Moabite Gentile named Ruth, for whom the book of Ruth is named. Boaz married Ruth, and they became the parents of Obed, who was the father of Jesse, who was the father of David. David then was only 3 generations away from the Gentile Ruth, and 4 generations from the harlot Rahab. This also meant that just 5 generations before David, the future king's great-great-great-grandfather was born into slavery. And his great-great-grandfather was born in the desert under a pillar of fire sometime after his parents were freed from Egypt. Today it's not unusual to see photos from family reunions that include 5 generations. That is how close King David was to his people's time as slaves in Egypt. In fact, merely 1 generation before David, until Saul became king, no real nation of Israel existed. The land was certainly there, but there was no central government, no standing army, and no monarchy, only a loose confederation of agrarian tribes that knew little about warfare. These Hebrew tribes bickered and fought among themselves to the point of outright combat. Throughout the land, there were also various pagan groups and tribes that surrounded, mingled with, and terrorized the Hebrew people. To the south were the Amalekites, a depraved people who were violent raiders. They were to Israel what Vikings were to England during the early medieval period. To the west, the Philistines, while more sophisticated governmentally, were still barbaric and cruel. They had 1 military invention that gave them an advantage over the Hebrews. Iron. The Hebrew people had only bronze, but the Philistines fought with iron. Imagine an ancient game of rock, paper, scissors, but with only iron and bronze. Iron always beats bronze. The metal was so important that the Philistines forbade any Hebrew from owning iron or an iron forge. Until the time of Saul, just before David, the Hebrews were still in the Bronze Age, with no organized government, no constitution or bylaws, and no king. They were surrounded by barbaric enemies, who constantly raided and plundered. It was the Wild Wild West. Judges chapter 19 records an absolutely horrendous story that reveals exactly how spiritually bankrupt and governmentally primitive the tribes of Israel were at the time of Ruth. Just before Saul became king, a Levite traveler and his concubine came late to a town where they knew no one. an old man offered them refuge so they wouldn't have to sleep on the street. When a group of men came to the old man's home, demanding that he send out the Levite to them so that they could rape him, the Levite pushed his concubine out to them instead. The men raped her all night until she died. The next day, the Levite chopped up her body into 12 parts and sent them throughout the tribes of Israel as a call to action. In a strange coincidence, this despicable event took place in Gibeah, the town where Saul was later anointed the first king of Israel. Saul was certainly not Israel's greatest king, but he was the first. Based on the Judges chapter 19 story, Saul clearly grew up in a time far from civilized. The Israelites had been begging the prophet and judge Samuel for a king of their own, and Saul, a massive human being said to be head and shoulders taller than the next tallest person, was the man God chose for the task. Saul was a weak and carnal man, yet despite that, he was an important person in the life of Israel. He took the loose and violent tribal confederation he inherited when he became king, with tribes scattered from Dan to Beersheba, amid the surrounding pagan peoples, and created the seminal nation of Israel. The land at that time was not a nation with clear boundaries. In North America, Canada is the nation to the north of the continent. Going south, the United States is next, then Mexico, and so forth. No part of Mexico exists in Canada, and none of the 50 United States are down near Guatemala. Yet that is what Israel was at the time of Saul and young David. A Hebrew family from the tribe of Benjamin might be living next to an Amalekite village. David himself, for example, was born in the town of Bethlehem, within walking distance of Jebus, a major pagan stronghold that David the king would later transform into the new capital of Israel. Clearly, Saul inherited an untenable situation when he became king of Israel. And it is to his great credit that, to an extent, he brought national identity and monarchical order to a land where people did whatever seemed right in their own eyes. Saul's downfall was spiritual and emotional weakness. He was in bondage to his emotions. He was up with God, then down with God. He was a great leader, then a bad leader, a bold leader, then a prideful leader. He was double-minded and unstable, and ultimately paranoid. Finally, God had enough of Saul. Saul may have been king, but the Israelites were God's people, and he was determined to give them a new leader with a different heart. God sent the prophet Samuel to Saul to make this dreadful announcement. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, Samuel tells Saul, "Since you have rejected the Lord's command, he has rejected you from being the king of Israel. The Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to someone else, one who is better than you." Verses 26 and 28. Saul, the quintessential egotist, was stunned when Samuel told him the next king would be one who is better than you. Imagine how that sounded to Saul. Not only someone else, but someone better than you. Ultimately, Saul came to understand God's mind could not be changed. Instead, he pleaded with Samuel, "I know I have sinned, but please at least honor me before the elders of my people and before Israel by coming back with me so that I may worship the Lord your God." 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 30. In other words, Saul admitted in private that God had withdrawn his anointing from him and that he was no longer the king. Yet Saul begged to maintain the appearance of being king. He wanted to keep the power and the prestige, even if only for a short while. Samuel agreed, and the withdrawal of Saul's anointing remained a secret between them. Still, the road to kingship for one who is better than Saul had begun. For all spiritual purposes, that was the end of Saul's story. He was king for years afterward, but he was finished. Samuel left Gibeah for Bethlehem, the home of Naomi, Ruth, and Boaz. A man named Jesse, Ruth's grandson, lived in that village. Jesse had 8 sons, the youngest of whom tended to his father's flock. The boy's name was David. The two kings' lives would soon collide ferociously. One remained king in public, but was no longer king in reality. The other, while not yet a king in public, was a king in reality. One resided at a palace in Gibeah. The other lived in a sheep shed in Bethlehem. One was a mighty warrior, the king of a fledgling nation, while the other was a shepherd boy, both ridiculed and envied by his older brothers. How would God bring these two kings together? And when he did, what would happen when a power-crazy, emotionally bankrupt, psychopathic, murderous king who wanted to retain his hold on the throne crossed paths with an innocent, guileless adolescent upon whom rested the hand of God? Part 1. Mourning. If David had written an autobiography, I believe he would have emphasized that being the choice of God isn't all it's cracked up to be. Any person seeking to live for God faces excruciatingly tough decisions. Living out that passion for God in such a violent error as David's is what makes his story so raw and so maddeningly complex. It could be said that because of Saul's failures, God stripped David of his childhood. When most young boys are concerned with games, not national celebrity, David was being anointed king of Israel. At the age an average teenager today learns to drive, David cut off the head of a giant. During the years today's young adults attend college, start their careers, and plan their futures, David was an outlaw hiding in caves. David's early life is gut-checking. His life makes us rethink the whole question of what it means to be set apart by God for great things. Between David's anointing and his public coronation, decades of waiting and bloodshed and waiting and running and waiting and deceiving and waiting pass by. Years of waiting. Being a man after God's own heart means living life open and submitted to God's will and timing. It means telling him, "I'm yours, and I will trust in you no matter what." In David's case, no matter what meant no matter how many spears his father-in-law threw at him. Chapter 1. A strange boy, to say the least. Based on 1 Samuel chapter 16. When David first appeared in the story that was to become his, he was a shepherd boy. His life was far from those of the romanticized shepherds of modern stories. In David's day, the shepherd in the family was the runt, the youngest, and often the most despised by his elders, who was made a shepherd because he was not capable of much else. David had 7 older brothers, grown men who were strong warriors. They endured their younger brother. Barely. Jesse's 7 older sons thought David was strange, to say the least, and a bragging little liar, to say the worst. From his earliest days, David's life had a touch of the miraculous. Consider the fact that David was a master musician at a prodigious age. Prodigies are often hated by their less talented elders. Then there were his accounts of supernatural victories in the wilderness. Imagine an evening meal in David's family home. He has returned with his sheep, cleaned up, and joined his older, larger brothers at the kitchen table. Challenged by their mother to be nicer to David, they fire off questions between bites. "What did you do today, little brother?" one asked before immediately turning to his mother to make sure she noticed his effort. Guileless as the child he is, David answers without hesitation, "Today I killed a lion." Imagine the ridicule, the mockery he must have endured. Perhaps Eliab, the eldest, led the verbal assault. "Killed a lion, did you? Wow, that must have been dangerous business. It's a miracle you weren't killed." "Yes," agrees the naive child, "it was a miracle, a great miracle. How did you kill the ferocious beast?" David, oblivious to the sarcasm, answers, "I punched him." Imagine the laughter, gales of laughter. David begins to realize he is being mocked, but he presses on. "Yes, he ran at the sheep, and I hit him with my fist." "And he died, just like that? Wow." By now, everyone is up to speed on the conversation. The brothers are laughing together, and Jesse and his wife are smiling awkwardly and shaking their heads. "Yes, he died, just like the bear." "Oh, a bear too. A lion and a bear. What a warrior. What a mighty slayer of beasts is this sweet singer of songs." After what feels like an eternity to David, his father, Jesse, raises his hand, and the laughter ceases. "Okay, David, are you saying you killed a lion?" "And a bear," Abinadab adds. "Don't forget the bear, father." "And a bear?" Jesse asks. "A lion and a bear?" "Yes," David responds quietly. Jesse looks into the innocent eyes of his youngest and says, "The next time you kill a lion or a bear, why don't you cut off its head? Bring that head home and show it to your brothers, to all of us. No one calls anyone in this family a liar, and we're not calling you a liar, son, but next time, bring the head." The prophet arrives. One day, the prophet Samuel arrived in town. This was a big deal, especially in a village like Bethlehem. No paparazzi follow him. But Samuel was the most famous religious leader of his day. Samuel walking into Bethlehem would be something like a rock star today suddenly appearing in a small town, or Billy Graham showing up at a country church. Since anointing Saul as the first king of Israel, Samuel had nearly retired and taken a back seat in the kingdom. His return to the scene, his arrival in Bethlehem, was something of a scary moment. There was serious apprehension. What did this mean? The scriptures even say that the elders of the town were afraid upon seeing Samuel, and they hadn't even learned the reason he was there. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 4. They would have been shocked to learn that the reason for Samuel's appearance was treason, anointing a new king when a perfectly healthy king sat on the throne. Samuel doesn't waste any time upon entering Bethlehem. Samuel was hardly a folksy chap on his sunniest day. He is there on serious business. He tells the elders of the town, "Gather at Jesse's house for a sacrifice to the Lord." Jesse's house? What for? Some of them might have been wondering if he had come to rebuke Jesse's youngest for blasphemy. Had the boy's bizarre stories of miracles offended the great prophet? "I'm going there to anoint a new king," Samuel answers. The elders are shocked, probably horrified. Look, listen, we don't want to argue with a prophet. Please don't strike us dead or anything, okay? We're with you, all right? But, well, we do have just one tiny, maybe important, maybe not, question. What about Saul? Without hesitation, Samuel responds bluntly. "What about him? I have nothing to do with Saul anymore. The next king is in Jesse's house." That said, everyone gathers at Jesse's house. The torches are lit. The elders are assembled. There's a fearful mysteriousness in the room. Samuel goes straight to Jesse's oldest, strongest son, Eliab. He is a perfect specimen of a man. He looks kingly. Samuel thinks to himself, he's not Saul exactly, but he's impressive enough. Samuel holds out the oil, ready to anoint Eliab when he feels a spiritual check. This isn't the one. He looks to the next biggest one, Abinadab. Again, this isn't the one. The same story with Shemaiah and all the other brothers present. This isn't the one. This isn't the one. This isn't the one. After going through all seven brothers, Samuel's next words to Jesse prompt one of the funniest exchanges in the Bible. "Are you sure these are all your sons?" "Am I sure these are all my sons?" Jesse asks in disgust. "What are you accusing me of? What's wrong with my boys here? What do you mean, are these all my sons?" "Well, are they?" Silence. "Are they? I count seven sons. Is this right, Jesse?" Jesse becomes quiet and looks away before answering. There is another. Out in the field somewhere, the youngest. He is, well, what can I say? Samuel responds, "Let's see what God sees in him. Go find him now. We will not sit down or eat one bite until he is here." When David eventually arrives and sees everyone staring at him, he must have been thinking to himself, "What did I do now?" Quietly, he asks them, "Do you want to hear a song?" He has absolutely no idea what's happening, but as the youngest, he's used to being left out of the loop. Samuel walks over to this skinny child, smelling like sheep, with knees like a camel, a sunburned nose, tousled hair, and a banjo slung over his shoulder. Perhaps Samuel himself argued with God. "Oh, Lord, no, not this one, surely not this one." Samuel listens for the only opinion that matters. The words come. "This is the one." Immediately, Samuel tilts the horn, pours oil on David, and anoints him as the next king of Israel. His brother's reactions must have been priceless. Surely not aloud, not so Samuel could hear it, but they must have chafed. All their anger and envy must have made that mysterious evening a bitter pill to swallow. Then there were Bethlehem's village elders. They must have been afraid. They were present at this treasonous ceremony. If Saul found out about this, they knew he would kill them all and perhaps burn Bethlehem to the ground. David has no more idea than the others of what has happened to him. Nobody explained anything to him. He just came in out of the field, and an old man poured oil on his head. He looked to his dad with an uncertain look on his face. "You only have yourself to blame, son," Jesse says to him, "if you want to kill lions and bears with your bare hands. This is what happens." Lesson from old Dr. Mark. There will be moments in your life when God does something that resonates deeply with you. They ping on your sonar screen, and you just know that something big is going to happen. Then years go by, and nothing happens. The lost years don't erase God's mark on you, though. The announcement was still made. The time has simply not yet come. The next step. Wait. Perhaps even stranger than this scene with an old man pouring oil over a boy is that when it's over, it's just over. Samuel goes back to his lonely prophet's retreat, and David returns to his sheep. Everything goes back to normal, or so it seems. Yet nothing is ever normal again. God has made his mark on David, and David's story was just beginning. However, it's important to remember that David's story was not the only story being written. Saul's story was not yet finished. Just because David was anointed didn't mean it was time for him to take the next step. Rather, it was time for the next step, but that next step was simply to wait. God withdrew his anointing from Saul, who in turn fell into a demonic nightmare world. He was filled with rage and was guilt-ridden. The Bible puts it like this, a puzzling verse for many. An evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 14. Saul's troubled soul and his tortured mind were of his own making. God simply let Saul live with the torments he carved out for himself. Soon, Saul was having horrible nightmares and not sleeping well at all. A kind-hearted minion in his camp says to the king, "Hey, I heard about a kid over in Bethlehem who can play and sing better than anyone in Israel. Why don't I go get this kid and we'll see if he can sing you to sleep?" Saul is willing to try anything at this point, so he summons David to his camp. Now, what could David have been thinking at this point? Not too long before, the most famous spiritual leader in Israel poured oil over his head and said that David was God's choice to be the next king. Now the current king is sending for him. Did Saul know? What's going to happen to David? When young David arrives in the king's tent, Saul is tossing and turning and moaning behind a veil. All the oil lamps have been turned down, save for one flickering light, and the captain of the guard simply says to David, "Sit over there and play and sing for the king. See if you can get him to sleep." Here's young David, away from home and probably frightened. Secretly he knows he is supposed to be the next king, but he's told to play and sing for the current sleepless and tormented old king. It's a very odd and frightening moment in the young boy's life. Yet odd circumstances are nothing new for David. David plays, and at last the king sleeps. In time, David is sent back to Bethlehem. Saul and his army head out for battle, and nothing else happens for David. It's over. He simply goes back to shepherding. And that's exactly where God wanted him right then. Leadership focus. Promotion comes from the Lord. Young people today spend way too much time trying to force their way into opportunities. In fact, nobody is really immune to this. Whether we're fresh out of college or 20 years into a profession, when we see even the hint of an opportunity, our initial instinct may be to push the door open ourselves. We dare not promote ourselves to our next job. We cannot force others to see what only we can see or think we see in ourselves and kickstart our destiny into a higher gear. Promotion doesn't come from us or even from others. Promotion comes from the Lord and the Lord only. You are where you are right now because where you are is where God wants to use you right now. Maybe you've been told you're going to be the next king. Are you king now? David wasn't. David did his job there, right where he was. He was a shepherd, and he did it well. He was gifted in music, and he used it well. When he was given an opportunity to sing and play for, of all people, his demon-possessed predecessor, he did it well. Wait on the Lord for your next opportunity. When that opportunity comes, don't get caught in the snare of assigning too much significance to it. After David sang Saul to sleep, he didn't snoop around and start planning a hostile takeover. He didn't say to himself, God has finally brought me to my destiny. It's time to start my kingdom. He did what he was brought there to do, and then went home to his sheep. David had an opportunity to serve the king, and he did it well. That is all God wanted from him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.